November 30th, 1980. I was preparing to conduct the premiere of my score for the 5-hour silent film Napoleon at the Empire Cinema, Leicester Square. But let's flash back to 1972, the premiere of a 26-part documentary series called The World at War. This was produced by Thames Television and was an immediate success and is still running today. Several figures came together at that point, chiefly a man called Jeremy Isaacs, and World at War was his baby. He was head of the documentary department at Thames Television, and he was looking for a composer that would be fresh, up and coming, and able to kind of get along with his way of thinking about the series. The series made an immediate impact, and Jeremy was already looking forward to new work, in particular a series called Destination America. And that put me together with one of the key people involved in the Napoleon Project. That person was a ex-Royal Ballet dancer, now turned director. His name was David Gill. And after the screenings and transmission of Destination America, a new project was thought of, which involved yet another important person in this project, and that was the filmmaker and film historian Kevin Brownlow. The new project was a 13-part series called Hollywood. It was based on Kevin Brownlow's book, The Parades Gone By, which Jeremy had picked up sometime in the 1960s and had vowed to make a series. It was the authoritative book on silent film, and Hollywood was based on that. Now, I had always enjoyed silent films, occasionally had done some improvisations at college and in the service of other films, and it was intriguing. But I was to learn during the making of Hollywood really what really went on through researchers in Washington, New York, and in Los Angeles. I met living organists and pianists who were still working on the occasional revival performance, but I only learned through my reading and examining music that if you went to a top-class cinema in a West End or Broadway or, you know, the center of a town, you would actually see these films accompanied not just by a piano or organ, but by a full orchestra. And this way of playing and organizing and structuring your score to fit the film, do what the film needed, and really supply that extra element which we have come to expect in a film, didn't they? Dialogue and sound effects, you know, wasn't there. It was silent, unless you could provide it with good, appropriate, and if possible, inspired music. This was to be my job on the Hollywood series. But Kevin had another interest beyond Hollywood and silent film. In general, he had in his adolescence found a few reels, or was given a few reels, of an extraordinary French film called Napoleon. It was directed by an extraordinarily talented man, Abel Gance, who had managed to not only make these films, but to evolve really revolutionary techniques, in particular in camera movement. Cameras were on ends of ropes, swinging on horseback. The screen was not just one screen, but could be turned into 16 screens. The climax of the film was a total precursor of Cinerama, where the curtains, hidden curtains, part, and suddenly the screen is three times the width of a standard screen. However, after its premiere, which was a triumph, 1927 proved, in a way, a fatal moment in the life of Gance and the story of the film of Napoleon. That year was the proper introduction of sound on film, and that was the rage. And so when, by the later 20s, interest fell in silent film, but everyone got very excited by sound film. and Gauss's version and the true impact of the live orchestra and this extremely powerful film fell into a kind of ruin. The Hollywood series was screened first in January 1980 and was, for Thames Television, a great success. It sold round the world and was part of a whole program of Thames moving across into Los Angeles. And so World at War and other works that I had actually done for Thames, like, for instance, The Naked Civil Servant, began to move around the world. Kevin, at the same time, was beginning to build up the material for his version of Napoleon. And at that point in its history, he had achieved a print of just under 5 hours in running time. The managing director of Thames Television at that time, Brian Cowgill, was so excited and pleased with the reception to Hollywood that he said that he would fund, for a single performance, a screening of Napoleon with music by myself as a sort of celebration of the work of Thames Television. Kevin, with the help of the BFI, began to assemble the film, and I was sort of locked into a small editing room with piles and piles of reels and reels of film, you know, spending a day just looking at it piece by piece on what used to be called a Steenbeck. This machine had the film on separate reels and you watched it a reel at a time in those days when you actually could handle film. Now, here I was faced with this project. And so from my point of view, I was at that time not very experienced in conducting live orchestra performance. I had a lot of experience conducting in a studio where you can stop and repeat and correct. But this was entering a world which was not unlike ballet or opera. In a sense, the orchestra would be there in a pit or at any rate in front of a screen. It would be an orchestra of just under 50 players. I couldn't go back. It was live. And I would have to sustain the length, and I would have to create a score at the same time that would synchronize with the film. It had to follow all the moods of the film. And so this was a first for me. And the great question is, how do I organize it so that it would work? Obviously, we're not going to conduct or play for 5 hours. There were going to be intervals, just as in an opera or a ballet, when we could recover. But substantially, there it was. Find 5 hours of music and or compose 5 hours of music that would synchronize with this mammoth silent film. I have my own personal legend about this project, which is turning to my colleagues at a Thames Television party and saying, look, guys, I've just created 300 odd clips for the series. Why don't we do a whole film? After all, we learnt how they do it. And I had had this extraordinary experience of meeting the people who were still practitioners of it. I remember in researching the Hollywood series, going to the last organist at the Paramount Theatre, delightful woman, and saying to her, how do you put together these scores? And so she turned to a cupboard and opened the drawers, and there was floor to ceiling sheet music, and she began pulling things off the shelf, and she would say, oh, look at this piece, this is awfully good for chases, and here's this piece, this I use for erotic moments, and this is very good for comedy scenes, and so on. Is that she had worked out her library, and in assembling her scores, she would sort of have this huge library of music to choose from, and then she would carve it up into whatever way she needed. So I realized that the history of film music in its origins, you know, relied on music already written, could borrow from popular music of the day. You could go back into music history and exploit the great classics. And so in doing the Hollywood series, you know, I exploited this, and there were things I wrote and things I arranged, and together the art of it was to make it feel seamless. So that when I then got to the question of Napoleon, I did have this vast background and really fell back on basically my musical life going way back to my childhood, as I was a great sort of absorber of music. I was hungry for music. And so consequently, I knew a lot of music, and this was extremely helpful. But how would it help me in this situation of Napoleon, which really comes commerce and art joined together? It had to be effective at the same time. The criteria that we were going to rise to was going to be very high, and you couldn't play, because in the meantime, classical music had far more reach and exposure, and music is familiar to people. So if you use something very well known, you know, it immediately is not just the piece, but all the associations around the piece that people would recognize and say, oh, it's that and it's that. So I thought I have to be much more careful about if I was going to borrow from the classics. I had another problem, however, which was the performance was to be November 30th, 1980, and the final decision to go ahead with this performance and get all the things sorted out was not reached until August. So I had something like less than 4 months to assemble this. This led to another decision on my part, which is that there was no way I could actually compose 5 hours of orchestral music of my own to support this film. And so I had to ask myself certain questions about Napoleon and the time he lived in and who was writing at that time and what could I do so that the musical picture could broaden, so to produce a kind of parallel film, which was really the story of music at the time of Napoleon. There were three major composers. Of course, there were hundreds of composers, but there were three which have come down as great masters. The first in the queue is Haydn. The second is Mozart. And the third, and the central composer in our story, is Beethoven. They all knew each other, they had met, they had enormous respect for each other, and somehow within the three, you could actually find bits of Mozart that sound like Haydn and bits of Haydn that sound like Beethoven and so on. But they're all centered around the last decades of the 18th century and the beginning of the 19th century. And that goes beautifully with our story because of certain characteristics, particularly in Beethoven, which one might regard as Napoleonic. You know, first of all, is a sort of dynamism that is there, and you find in all three, but it's perhaps most notable and the strongest characteristic of Beethoven. Secondly, they worked in phrases and in contrast of moods, and somehow, if the gods are with me, they're going to synchronize because they have sharp points which can go very well with the edits of the film. So I was beginning to establish a kind of relationship between this late 18th century music and the way the film was edited. But chiefly, the question was dynamic. And now I want to talk about a very tricky thing, which is the relationship of Napoleon directly to Beethoven. Beethoven had rather conflicting views about Napoleon as the history evolved. Initially, Beethoven saw Napoleon as a liberator of the European people from monarchies and reactionaries, and a man who would bring the ideals of the French Revolution to the rest of Europe. His enthusiasm was such that he dedicated his third symphony to him, and the title page exists with this dedication on it. However, when Napoleon crowned himself Emperor of France, Beethoven changed his view and furiously crossed out the dedication, and the symphony simply became known as the Eroica Symphony, with no reference to Napoleon at all. There are stories about Beethoven cowering under a table when Napoleon's army was bombarding Vienna. There are equally stories of, towards the end of Beethoven's life, where he's quoted as saying, "I never got that bastard." But I got interested in the music of that period from another standpoint. Obviously, one can quote from the great masterworks by these three composers, Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven. But there was another side to it I wanted, which is that these guys had to work for a living. They needed commissions, they needed royalties, and so they did jobs. All three worked in the theater. They wrote dance music for people to do their German dances and their minuets and so on. They wrote incidental music for plays. They wrote songs. They made a practice of searching out people, mostly nobility, who would commission works. There were musical societies that commissioned work and so on. It was not the situation of today where there were collecting societies and various ways in which composers could exist. Very often you might get a commission and that was it. You had no control. So I got very interested in what were they doing? What were their jobs like, you know, when people asked them to write something for them? Because I knew it would be slightly different, as though, yes, today we can write symphonies and string quartets, but we can also write film music and television music and so on. So, you know, then you start discovering that, you know, that they all had this, the three of them had this thing about jobs, and the quality of the music that they did for something like that was slightly different. It was slightly more immediate. It was not to be studied. You know, it had to make its impact right away. And I thought maybe there's something, if I look there at a ballet, dance music, an overture to a play, incidental music to a play, etc., it might be really rather interesting because it would have this directness. And I thought that would help me a great deal. So here I am, surrounded by these masterworks and this huge quantity of music. And I simply began to add. I mean, you start somewhere at the beginning and think, what would be a good piece for this wonderful opening of the film, which is a snowball fight at a military academy where Napoleon, a child, was there as a young cadet. And I began to think, I know that Mozart symphony written by the young Mozart in his teens. Let's look for young Mozart because I'm dealing with Napoleon as a child. So here's this fabulous and aggressive and rather Beethoven-like piece by Mozart, his 25th symphony. Haydn was also very useful to me because conveniently, across the several hundred years since he wrote his 104 plus symphonies, they all began to sprout useful titles. So you have The Philosopher, you have The Hunt, you have The Clock, you have all sorts of interesting clues and say, well, maybe the mood is going to be, you know, useful. It might imply something or other. But there were some other factors as well that began to come in as the score progressed, which was this, is while the film itself is a biographical film, it is made in it was premiered in 1927. So in the few years leading 1925, he may have started it, not quite sure of that, when he actually began to work on the film. But he's very much a man of the 20th century. And I'm now talking about the director and writer of the film, which is Abel Gance. Gance's interpretation, therefore, of the saga of Napoleon is very much of its day. He himself saw Napoleon as a progressive figure and presents a very positive side to his character because there are the opposite view of him as a tyrant and dictator. It was also a widely held view. I've read that views of Napoleon changed with France's place in history. If France was going through a calm and prosperous period, then Napoleon was seen in a rather villainous light. However, if France was going through a very stressful time and confused time, then the figure of Napoleon as someone who would bring people together was prevalent. So somewhere in this was knowing that this was not a documentary film we were making. I had to tell Gance's version of the history of Napoleon. So that for that, presenting a kind of 20th century view, and also with the aim of filmmaking, you know, is that there had to be a romantic side to it, a romantic and heroic side, which was not quoting from 18th century composers, but had to somehow reflect the movies, you know, with its exaggeration and its definite editorializing. So for that, I had to find my own music in myself. And that then led me to illustrate an image that goes through the whole film, and that is of the eagle. I had to rely on my own instincts about whether writing my own music would fit in with the three I chose as my models. So I began and thought about the eagle. It had to be imperious. It had to fly. So I sketched something. Now, our working procedure with my colleagues, David Gill and Kevin Brownlow, was they'd come to my house and I would play them the score. The trick was to see if my own music could fit seamlessly into a score which had big chunks of Beethoven, Haydn, and Mozart. Now, we had a working pattern. David Gill and Kevin Brownlow would come round to my house, and I had a piano and a TV, and they would bring a video, and I would play, and we would watch the film together, and they would interrupt or make points to me about did the thing work together. So here we go, we started, we had some chunks of Mozart, we had developments of the Mozart themes, and then suddenly we came to the scene of Napoleon, a little boy, alone in an attic with his pet. His uncle had given him a baby eagle in a cage. So I played my eagle theme. Kevin exclaimed, "Who wrote that?" November 30th, 1980, the day of the show. It was a long day because the show was starting at, I believe, 10:30 in the morning and would extend to well after 5 at night. There was quite a long queue outside the Empire, and I'd been cheered up in a sort of cynical sort of way because I had heard that there were many ticket touts around, always the sign of a commercial success. It really was packed, and as they say, all of London was there. It was a case of doing the job. There was a start to it, and you know, you just kept playing until you got to the end. Funny things happened in the middle of the third act. For some reason, there was so much music that the parts fell on the floor, and there was a terrible silence with nothing but me screaming, "Play, play," which eventually they did do. There's no question that the combination of events did make a great impression. It felt new. Live music played by an orchestra fitting the film, and the mixture of original music and the selections from Haydn, Mozart, and principally Beethoven made a very deep impact and had very serious implications for all of us, David, Kevin, myself, about how we were going to go on. This month marks the 40th anniversary of that first performance.
Thank you.